Hello again. Welcome. I want to start off by announcing some good news. I just received word that 50 new Wikipedia articles on women architects have been created already. So today has already been a success. I'm Michaela Lynch. I'm an associate manager at the Guggenheim and founder of the Guggenheim Wikipedia Initiative. I want to thank you all again for joining us for our third Wikipedia Editathon, or Gugathon, as we affectionately like to call it. The focus of this year's Gugathon is women in architecture. The topic for architecture was a natural fit because, as you all know, it's October, New York's month-long celebration of architecture and design. And the decision to tie our editing practice to women was also straightforward, but it was also personal, especially for those of us on staff working on this, and it was particularly personal for me. Just to give you some context, I'm not an architect. I'm in fact applying to business school currently. And over the past year, I've spent a lot of time thinking critically about my career and the impact I want to have. As sort of field research for this, I read a lot about women business leaders that I admire or those who I want to model my career after. And I often turn to Wikipedia sort of looking for clues and patterns and insights as to what has constituted their own success. But I'm less interested in the careers of, say, a Sheryl Sandberg or a Marissa Mayer. I'm much more interested in the women in power positions at hedge funds, global finance institutions, big blue chip companies like GE, Boeing, Procter & Gamble, the women who are sort of quietly moving the needle but aren't in the news cycle. They're really the women you haven't heard of. To give you an example, Dame Stephanie Shirley, better known as Steve Shirley, founded a tech business in the early 1960s. It was one of the first software startups in the UK at that time. Stephanie Shirley changed her name to Steve, as you can imagine, to get a leg up in a male-dominated business. Steve was a child refugee leaving Nazi-occupied Vienna at 5 years old with her sister and settled in England, where she was raised by her foster parents. She founded her software company in the 1960s at a time when women couldn't drive a bus or pilot an airplane or open up a bank account without their husband's permission. She named her business Freelance Programmers, starting it at her dining room table, financed by what would be the equivalent of $100 today. She sought to employ only professionally qualified women who had left the workplace because of marriage or the arrival of children. The innovative, flexible working model that Steve developed around wives and mothers was as such. Women worked from home, writing machine or binary code by hand on paper and mailed it to a data center where it was punched onto paper tape and then entered into a system. That was essentially the model of programming in the 1960s, where the only mode of technology was a paper, pen, and a telephone. Steve's company pioneered software standards on management control protocols that were eventually adopted by NATO. Further, Steve's programming team, again, women working from their living rooms, developed the pioneering software behind the black box flight recorder of the supersonic Concorde. Freelance Programmers was eventually valued at $3 billion and employed 8,500 people, churning out 70 millionaires when the company floated the stock market. Steve was also one of the first to offer stock options to employees. Steve went on to found the Oxford Internet Institute, and also as the mother of an autistic son, much of her wealth is poured into research and think tanks related to advancing treatment and services of child autism. When I hear a story like Dame Steve Shirley's, I feel like I no longer have an excuse. Like I feel like I'm a little bit more freed up from self-doubt because I know I will never face a fraction of the obstacles that Steve had to face. And so achieving my own version of success seems a little bit out of reach. And that's where I feel the power is. I think that's why we're here, because when we see or learn of women in the corner office, as university deans, as business owners, as board chairs, when we see them in the White House, we're somehow more accountable for crystallizing our own path and our own dreams. And if there's a greater collective of consciousness about the precedents and successes of women, then the women now who are charting their own course are galvanized and empowered. I'm certain that the discussions this afternoon and the entries made into Wikipedia later on will bring more of these key women into the forefront, that there will be more examples of success to point to and to be inspired by. We wouldn't be here today without some key people in the room. I want to thank the Beverly Willis Architecture Foundation, our key collaborators and partners for today's event. The foundation produced an archive of American architects and related research, which will be key components that will serve as source material for our editing later today. Of course, I want to thank our incredible panelists for raising the standards of the architectural profession and architectural history. You are the true catalyst for meaningful change, working where sort of the rubber meets the road and really inspiring us all along the way. To our friends at WikiD, Women, Wikipedia, and Design, Wikimedia New York City, and Wikipedia chapters all over the world for helping us scale the event to include over a dozen participating cities. To my partner, an architect, for being my sounding board and for your counsel and insight on this topic, your support has been invaluable. To my Guggenheim team for your patience, thoughtfulness, and alacrity every step of the way, you have made my wild wiki dreams come to life, and I am forever in your debt. So now it is a great pleasure to introduce our first speakers, the women behind the Denise Scott Brown petition, Ariel Asseline Lichten and Caroline James.
Hi, thank you, Michaela and the Guggenheim, for organizing this great event.
It's been wonderful. Even just the planning for this has been really fun. At a certain point, we said to Michaela, when should we stop connecting you and reaching out to other people? And she's like, no, there's no more the merrier. So there's right now something I don't know what the number is, 18 or 20 global events. So hello, UK, hello, Bangalore, hello, Toronto, everyone. I mean, it's just amazing. So we're really happy to be here.
There we go. Okay. So I'm Ariel Asseline Lichten. In 2013, I founded a multidisciplinary design firm called Slash Projects, where we do architecture, interdisciplinary, interactive, and product design. And it was really a way for me to both continue my architecture practice and test new modes of practice. And that kind of stemmed out of the idea of being able to expand what we consider architectural practice. And as an activist, I really kind of started thinking about activism and being able to change the world while studying at NYU, and I studied critical theory, and so it was really about understanding underlying kind of modes that that inhibit us from changing the status quo, and how can we overcome that. And so I think from that belief that we can take action and change the world is where this petition started, and that there was a real need in architecture to make a bold move and bring progress now.
There's an advancer. Yes. Oh, great. We both have the power to advance the slides, I'm just realizing. So I didn't study architecture as my major in undergrad because of a simple phrase that just came into my mind when I was a freshman and walking by the architecture building at 2 a.m, the black clad, cigarette smoking people outside. And I just said, I don't want to go through that pain. That's the only thing I said, it was survival mode. And, but I really liked architecture. I thought it was really exciting, but everyone I've talked to, said, don't go into architecture. And one of my, one person who I really care about said, if you go into architecture, you're going to be designing where light switches go. well, that doesn't sound like much fun. You know, so I ended up, after studying Italian and art at college, I then went and spent time, I just decided, you know what, I have to get out of the US. Like, I didn't know what I was gonna do, so I went to Japan and Thailand for 3.5 years working as a teacher and then in media and in communications and product design, and I started to cross over with architects and I said, I'm gonna try this. You know, it's been 4 years, I'm ready to go through this pain now. So I then applied to architecture school and it did not let me down. It was exactly what I thought it was gonna be, but it was really inspiring. And I think I was always aware about just how there were really no women in my first syllabus in theory class. She was the only woman on the entire syllabus. So the
problem really starts here, where 50% of students studying architecture are women. So there isn't a disparity in terms of education, and that's kind of where we begin this kind of understanding where the disparity begins.
And you know, it starts like, so 50% are women in the school, so it's like, yeah, it's great. And then like, as the bar keeps getting set higher and higher. I love this graphic by Lian Chang, one of our classmates at the design school. So, you know, as you get up in the ranks in architecture through licensing, through and the different levels of prestige, the amount of women just keep dropping off, and that's a problem. Then you just, you know, as a woman, you don't see other women in positions of decision makers. So, you know, you get up to these, the higher, the upper echelon, the Pritzker Prize, gold medal, there's no one really, or, well, we'll tell you how there's a couple now.
And we were just also looking, you know, at comparables, and so the Nobel Prize was awarded to a woman in 1903 as compared to the Pritzker Prize in 2004. So there's a huge gap in that timeline.
So I really loved at the design school, I really loved student groups because you could kind of like secretly just, not secretly, but you could just create your own programming and invite people who you wanted to talk to. It wasn't just about who was offered on the lecture panel. So I had talked with one of my friends who's Sally Young at the Loeb Fellowship Program, and she was having Billy Sien and Todd Williams coming in as Loeb Fellows, senior Loeb Fellows. And I had wanted to, I was saying, oh, we should do women in design, let's start this again. And I found out that it just disappeared. It was there when I first got to Harvard, it was a student group, and then it wasn't, no one had done it. And that's the problem in architecture schools, you're so zapped for time. You know, you probably all know this, but you have no time besides studio, so these groups just ebb and flow and wane. So I then just, I got together with some friends and said, why don't we just do a relaunch? So we invited Billy Sien, and the format was really important. It was a breakfast, it was a table. There's a phrase, there's no meeting if there's no eating. You know, like you get together people and food and conversation, and it's not about just having someone talk at you, but actually having a conversation. And that's one of the ways that we can actually look at like how things are made rather than just looking at the hero. So So that was March 23rd, and then
the next slide shows.
Oh, sorry, March 26th. That was March 26th, and then.
And then, relating to, yeah,
I don't know. Just go for it. Okay. Go for it.
I mean, to talk about just understanding that not only are women being excluded from receiving the prizes, but they're also being excluded from being part of the decision makers on the panel. So this infographic kind of nicely displays the lack of women participating both as jury and as winner, and then completely absent from the gold. And then another kind of infographic showing, you know, when in 2004 Zaha Hadid, but up until that point there were 4% of women who were registered architects in 1988. So it's a very gradual, I wouldn't call it an ascent, but it's a gradual trend, kind of getting to the point where one partnership, half a partnership, and one woman are awarded, so slowly kind of moving to this point. And then, of course, like the story of Robert Venturi winning in 1991, excluding Denise Scott Brown as his 30-year-long partner, co-founder of their firm together, and really counterpart. And there are a lot of kind of regulations on the part of the Pritzker Prize indicating why this, you know, this had to kind of proceed as it did. Let's see. And so that kind of led up to the point where 25 years later, Denise Scott Brown publicly announces that she deserves recognition. So she boldly, in an address, says, I deserve recognition for half of that prize. And so on, you know, a regular architecture blog like Dezine, one morning on March 27th, I was reading this article and seeing all the mean Dezine comments stream in and feeling really angry about it. And so I really felt like somebody needed to take action and students needed to speak up and support her. And to me, Denise Scott Brown, and I think to a lot of us, is also, she likes to be known as the grandmother of architecture. And so it was about creating a support system for her to receive the recognition that she undoubtedly deserves.
And we know the whole like thing also, we've become really aware of like the biases. So like, for example, a woman cannot like say what she's done or what she's achieved because it'll be seen as bragging, you know? So there's a lot of that going on. And so I think that Denise had been, ever since 91, absolutely outraged that she had never been recognized. You know, she did not attend the awards ceremony in Mexico City. She hung out with a group of ladies in this community in Mexico City. But it took really the social, it took the internet, it took a group of students, it took someone else being that mouthpiece for her. Oh, and then.
And then, you know, we all started to look into it and saw that in 1991 there was an article published in the New York Times signed by the staff of the Yale Journal of Architecture, who also wrote in outrage about the decision, but it kind of never really went anywhere. And so I think that relates to the idea of creating a critical mass to gather around the issue. And so we started campaigning in order to garner support.
So, I mean, it was like the Women in Design relaunch, this coincidental, or not, you know, moment that happened. Arielle and I then just spring into action from that moment forward. Arielle's doing her thesis at the time. I'm drowning in studio work, and we're just like moving forward. Like this is going. So on change.org, you know, I remember just update. This page is very familiar to me. I remember just like refreshing, and seeing the amount of supporters climb. It's kind of slowed down since, but I still know. I visit there like every day to this website. If you all haven't signed, please sign. Denise asked if we could do an extra push. She's 84 this October, so. But anyways, so people are streaming in, right? There's a lot of people who are signing, and you know, we are very active in structuring. How are we outreaching? You know, it's kind of architectural. We really set up a structure. So we emailed, it was very person to person, and really like even just in GSD, you know, it's this tray where you see everyone and we were going around and asking people to sign.
Yeah, I think that we really took a very tactical and systematic approach on one level of how we were going to garner support. We approached kind of heads of academia and then trickled down through faculty and then students. Which was actually very effective. And then this is a little bit of behind the scenes maneuvering that we did, where we got supportive faculty to give us confidential email addresses to high profile architects. And within an hour, Zaha was like, no problem. This should be dealt with. So from that moment, we just started seeing hundreds of signatures roll in and a lot of excitement around it because it had kind of achieved a bit of legitimacy.
We were making these little flyers and passing them out to people at the school. And I remember one day I saw Farshid Mousavi at the head of like right by our cafeteria, like, and I dashed down the stairs of the GSD, the Gund Hall, and I'm like, have you signed the petition? And she says that she'll sign. So it was, you know, and then also all of our classmates were blasting around. So we were very tactical also in saying, okay, who are the Pritzker Prize winners and who can we approach? So we actually went systematically and emailed every single living Pritzker, past Pritzker winner, and we kind of thought, like, who would sign if they got the prize? Why would they ever sign? But in fact, like, absolutely they signed. 10 of them signed. So, you know, we just, and some of them, everyone has a story. One of them, for just to share, for Rafael Mineo, I was friends with his TA and said, hey, can you get, you know, can you ask Rafael if he'll sign? And I went into Rafael's office at the GSD, and he takes out his fountain pen, and he writes down the comment he wants to leave to about Denise. And then I, like, go on his Gmail. It's really awkward. I'm, like, entering him on the change.org, and we sign it up, and he's signed. So, you know, everyone is a story. So, anyways, like, on change.org, there's an option that you can leave a quote on why this is important to you. So here are some of the quotes from the Pritzker Prize winners. Most of them left a comment.
And
it was cute.
A lot of these also, so some of these are from the Pritzker Prize winners, but a lot of them also evoke the different types of sentiments people have towards Denise and her legacy. So some of them are about her being a role model, some of them are about her legacy and her work, some of them are just her being an inspiration. And so we've been cataloging those comments and tagging them and trying to understand, you know, how this movement, because it's greater than the sum of its parts, affected so many different people in different ways.
So another thing, like, we had a lot of, like, another thing, in addition to being systematic about, like, the prize winners, we also were systematic about reaching out to the architecture schools. So, you know, like, who is, like, going on where, and we just sent out emails to everyone, like, the deans at the schools, and really tried to get their support. And for the most part, people signed on. And there was a couple of exceptions. Like, one person said, oh, I agree this should happen, but I really don't like the use of your word demand, because we had said we demand that Denise get recognition. So he said, I'm not signing. So actually, Ariel and I had, like, kind of jokingly said, oh, we'll start a petition that says, oh, excuse me, would you please give recognition, and I wonder if he would have signed. I would have liked to put him up to that, but anyways.
So the We Are All Denise, again, kind of encapsulating the idea that she is also representative of so many of the systematic issues that currently kind of exist in professional practice of architecture.
RISD and Stephen Worcester.
At the same time, we were reaching out to press and doing basically actively trying to engage the media in drawing attention to our issues. So these are some of the places that the article was published, and of course, like media happens to do, it kind of set fire and people are all of a sudden contacting us. And one of the main stories that came out was thanks to Caroline reaching out to Robin Pogrebin, a kind of front page of the art section, Partner Without the Prize, New York Times article that talked about, it was an interview with Denise, an interview with us, and just kind of really trying to understand the whole issue. And that also helped to grow the campaign.
Oh, I'll just add that we were in Gund Hall, like, and the photographers came, and, like, I was, like, ducking, hiding from my studio critic because he was, like, really not happy he was not happy that I was taking time away from studio, and so I was, like, hiding. And then we came outside, and then the photographer said, "They told me to try. You should try to look angry." So that's also laden with a lot of interesting things, like. Smiling girl, not as compelling as, like, mean girl, you know? So, anyways, I don't think we did a very good job at looking angry.
There were a lot of really awkward B-roll shots from that whole photo shoot.
Don't Google it, please.
And so, yeah, these are some of the exchanges that we had with Martha Thorne, the executive director of the Pritzker Prize, where she kind of essentially dismissed all of our attempts at starting a dialogue with the prize and helping them evolve. And so there was just a tone of kind of, you know, there's nothing we can do, and so please stop bothering us. And finally, we sent back, I think,
we were just writing letters, and that was something that just took, it was a huge responsibility, to tell you the truth. Like, it was just kind of like, all of a sudden, we have to craft, you know, this message that's going to be very public, because, like, when June 14th, I was, you know, Ariel and I are both, it's middle of the summer, Thursday evening, we get the only official response from the Pritzker Prize. Martha had been emailing with us, and, you know, she was kind of, she's really trying to help, to try to make, I think she was trying to make some kind of dialogue, but this is a letter from the Peter Palumbo, the chair of the, Lord Peter Palumbo, the chair of the Pritzker Prize, that said, oh, I'm really sorry, but, you know, this has never been done, you know, we've never looked things back, sorry, we can't do anything. And that Denise is now eligible for the Pritzker Award. So that's something that's on our to-do list, you know. But basically, so then we had to reply, because he sent this email, and then 1 minute later, they put it up on the press. So all of a sudden, you know, it was like not trying to engage us in a dialogue, but actually just blast us with some response, you know. So we had to then reply very quickly with the letter. The letter on the far right, you know, replied quickly. We, like, put it on our letterhead, you know, we just, you know, made a response saying, like, I'm sorry, like, we just don't accept that response. We're not stopping now. And then it was really, there's just so many stories. Like, I was on the phone for 2 hours with this really famous architect, and he was trying to tell me, like, how it's embarrassing that we're doing this petition and that we should stop it, and that, you know, wouldn't it be great to create a scholarship fund, and you know, he'll give $2,000, and I'm like, add a few more zeros. and then we get this letter. It was so odd. We get this letter from someone who had signed, and it's this official letter, like, I have signed the petition. Oh, a bit too fast. You know, and he's right now saying, oh, I'm sorry, actually, it's wrong what you did. There's this brilliant idea coming from and about raising money to endow a chair in Denise's name. You know, so it's just kind of like, okay, I'm sorry, but we don't have the ability to hack into change.org and take your signature off. But we could make it public if you want. We could say, hey, this person does not, we didn't. You know, we wrote back and said, I'm sorry, we just can't, you've already signed online. We don't know how to undo it.
So, kind of thinking about what are the outcomes, the prize was not retroactively awarded to Denise Scott Brown, as we all know, but there are many amazing things that have come as a result of just starting the conversation and bringing, I think, a lot of light on the fact that the Pritzker is an antiquated institution. And so,
well,
my favorite...
This is great. Ariel did this, like, editing on Wikipedia.
I think it's very apt for today. So this also started my kind of venture into becoming a Wikipedia editor. And the best way I knew to make that information known was to just start editing their page. And so for months I was having a little bit of an editing war with their their main, I guess the person who maintains their page. And every day I would go in and change it back. And finally, it stuck. It's still there. So the number one issue on the table of contents is controversy, which I think is fantastic. And I've had many people come up to me and say, "Did you know on the Wikipedia page it says controversy?" And I'm like, "I know." So that's fantastic. It has a huge impact, and that totally changes the way we perceive of the institution and our ability to change, you know, how it feels so monumental, but actually it can be adjusted and it can be malleable.
Oops. Yeah, so, I mean, there were a lot of ripple effects, and I think it's like part of this watershed moment that we're all in, you know, and zeitgeist of the time of inclusion, recognition, you know, recognition that there's been a massive gap between what's been made in architecture and what's been actually recognized as being made, you know, And that has a huge problem. It's a huge problem for people. Like, you know, think of me as a young woman in school and only seeing one female writer. It's like, like, you kind of think, is this a profession for me? I mean, there's only one other woman, you know? So in 2013, basically about, 6 months after the petition was created, the AIA National created a rule change to allow two individuals to win the gold medal. The gold medal is, as you all know, the highest honor by AIA, and it has never been given. It had never been given to a woman in the 108 years of the award's existence. And Denise and Bob had been applying for decades together, and every year their application would get returned to them unopened because they said, "Oh, I'm sorry, we only give it to one person." And of course, there are many cheerleaders for Robert Venturi to get the award. But they had done kind of a back alley agreement that, okay, Pritzker, we did, but I'm not doing this alone. So he would not get the gold medal alone. And so that rule change is monumental.
And around the same time, while we were still struggling to achieve, you know, success on our end, we received an email from someone in Germany who said, you know, we started a petition because, because the Gottfried Semper Architecture Prize was only awarded to Matthias Sauerbruch and not to Louisa Hutton, and they're equal partners. And so within 3 days, the prize totally rescinded and awarded both of them, which to us was a huge success because it was both an example of other people taking this movement on into their own hands and effecting change on the local level. And hopefully there are kind of more examples of that to come.
Yeah, and like it's also, it's magical thinking because the prize for the Gottfried Semper Award says it has to be given to a German, you know, and Louise Hutton is not German. So they said, you know what, like, we don't care if she's not German. She gets recognition, you know? So this kind of magical thinking, it's not about these rules, which, by the way, the Pritzker rules, which we point out in our July 14th letter, the Pritzker rules are made by the Pritzker jury. It's not like law. Like, you know, we titled this petition for Justness because justness is kind of sounds like justice, but justice is like this more of a formal, like, legal term, you know, justice, like, and it's kind of like what a society dictates, and then a higher power says, yes, you will grant this, we say this is just. Justness is more, the title of our talk is more related to what's fair, and what is right, and what is correct, you know, so this has been, it's a corrective action. It's not about, okay, like, yeah, back in 1991, the jury decided something. And then one other really important recent outcome, Julia Morgan, this was another petition. So there's another, basically an AIA medal winner, she's a licensed architect and she's a lawyer, and this person contacted us, Julia Donahoe contacted us and said, hey, I'm starting a petition to give Julia Morgan the AIA gold medal. And Julia Morgan had been deceased for some 60 years, but she had been as prolific as, you know, Frank Lloyd Wright in terms of building, and she had never received a gold medal, because no woman had ever received a gold medal. And in 2014, she became the first ever woman to receive a gold medal.
Just to talk quickly a little bit about women in design and how we formulated, or we kind of rebuilt the organization, and part of that was giving it a strong identity, and it really didn't have one, and as a designer, I couldn't understand why that would be, so
right.
I designed a new logo for the organization, which we kind of used as like a seal, or we felt like we could paste it on
like
the letterhead
Batman,
and feel very like empowered by it.
So people who are not GSD grads, the H is the Harvard, like, GSD logo, and then Arielle made this brilliant move of, like, shadow, like, Batman, women. It was really great. And so then, in between all the studio work that I was doing, I was also, like, leading this, or trying, not leading, but, you know, women, wait, I'm not supposed to say I was leading. I was
Chair?
Collaborating. I was chairing this organization, Women in Design, and it was really, I think it started out sort of small because it was kind of being rebubbling to the surface. It had had a history though. In 2008, Denise Scott Brown was the class day speaker, and they had a conference about women in design. But I just think at that point, it was just kind of more of like an inside, like preaching to the choir kind of conversation about, you know, inclusion. And now it's become a lot more, I think, not just about women really, but about equity in a field as a whole, related to inclusion, you know, whether it's, you know, about women or race or socioeconomic, you know, but it's about really like who, you know, this is all about inclusion. So, you know, the things that we are doing are really important. Like, I remember one person coming up to me and saying, you know, I was really surprised at the breakfast that it wasn't just some cafeteria, like, preservative-filled, run-of-the-mill breakfast, but someone had made scones, you know? And so she ended up taking on, she was kind of the women design food czarina. She loved making food because it's not just women's work, but it's about inviting people, it's about design, right? And this was an incredible moment. The Harvard Design School officially invited Denise in the fall of 2013, to come to Harvard to give a lecture. So she gave a lecture called Mayhew's Architecture. Because actually, Denise, we joke about how really Denise was the perfect victim of the petition, in the sense, we never knew her before we started the petition. It was 4 days after the petition had started and that we met her on the phone, and she was delighted. Do you remember the first time we talked with her?
Yes,
it was so cute. She was like, I've been up since 4 a.m. reading all the comments on change.org. It was really amazing. So we then were really talking with her, and so she's a real, real strong force behind all this. And the topic of Mayhew's architecture that she gave the talk on was all about how the petition can be read as a social document. There's thousands of comments that we're right now, as Ariel mentioned, we're analyzing about why this is important to people. And some people, it's important, the petition is important because of Denise. They worked for her, they loved her, learning from Las Vegas. For others, it's like, hey, like, I'm an African-American woman, I've been in the back room my whole, at the office, and I'm never getting recognition. That's why this is important to me, you know? So she called it Mayhew's architecture because she's reading it as a social document and why it's important. And so we had a discussion when she was there. Ariel came up from New York to Boston, and we had some of Denise's old students who are now professors. And we had a discussion about the range of architecture practice and where are you on the range and issues of recognition. This is a site visit to Toshiko Mori's Novartis office building in Cambridge. So women in design, just to say, we get out and about. It's about, you know, breaking down those walls, right? About exposing, oh, how are things made? So this is Sheila Maney's the director, CEO of Bjark Ingels Group, and she had a intimate lunch with us, and this is the food czarina's work. Sarah Kantowitz, who's now the chair of Women in Design, she's in her third year, and so she made this, like she like engineered the plates and everything. So just to say, we had the first ever International Women's Day, which is now a yearly event, and the first year it started out kind of slow, and the next year it just got bigger and bigger. So it's this amazing time. It's International Women's Day is a worldwide event, and this at the Harvard Design School, it's about recognizing the contributions of women. So like some of our work, we just continue like we're doing today. We continue to like just develop conversation, talk with people, meet with people. At every major architecture event, I'm working with one of my mentors, Louise Braverman, who's in the audience today. We work together to like kind of graft onto existing architecture events around the world. And some of these events, they didn't want us there really at all. So we just kind of inserted ourselves there and just made space.
And then thinking about, again, today's events later on about rewriting history and invisibilities This is an Invisibilities Wikipedia editing session that I had organized 2 years ago, and it was really about looking at, it started because I started looking at, you know, Lu Wenyu and Wang Shu, Wang Shu was also awarded the Pritzker Prize in 2012 without his partner, Lu Wenyu. And it began because I was looking for more information about her and found no page at all. So I created the page on the left with my limited knowledge of Lu Wenyu, and you can see there's a huge disparity in the amount of information that's being recorded. And that really ties into the importance of being a contributor into the production of knowledge and how Wikipedia is really only written by 13% women, which affects the content that is produced. And there are a lot of controversies about bullying and legitimacy of information because there are certain ways of sourcing that will make an article permanent. But what I found also so interesting about when I revisited the page that I had started to see that it stuck, it had been categorized by some of the administrators on Wikipedia. And so Lu Wenyu was categorized as a woman architect and a Chinese architect. And so I thought, well, what's Wang Shu categorized as? And so I scrolled way down to the bottom of his page, and he had, you know, 10 different categories, but one of them was living people. And so I thought, well, is she not getting categorized as a living person too? And so I think it's really important for us to kind of think about how these classifications affect the way we find knowledge and the way it's disseminated, and that's so important about what we're going to be working on today.
It's really exciting.
And then this is just a sort of visualization of, you know, different women's pages compared to, as Frank Lloyd Wright has, you know, 4,600 edits over the last 12 months, and then you can see it, Lino Bobardi had 60. So it's
crazy.
A visual example of, you know, where the disparity lies.
So just, I mean, the conversation is really, it's part of, as you all know, really a greater movement around the world, and this is one example of many, but missing 32% equity by design, spearheaded by Rosa Shang in San Francisco. So missing 32% refers to the fact that only 18% of women licensed architects, and that was not a sentence, but you know what I mean. And so compared to 4% in 88, sure, it's gotten better, but we have a long way to go. And we think this really is a moment that everyone is a part of, that people are looking at recognition and inclusion in really deep ways, and this is so incredible that we're here today in this beautiful, curvaceous space, by the way.
And then a kind of seminal article that was the cover of Metropolis magazine by Alexandra Lang, really calling for a new set of best practices, and that will be a design project in and of itself, and how will we create this new generation of architecture practice in the future. And so we've really kind of started to identify this zeitgeist toward that, looking back towards responsibility and accountability, not only in terms of you know, women and minorities, but also how the work is affecting laborers and other kind of organizations that are acting to protect labor within architecture and outside, and then also the formation of the first ever nonprofit architecture firm in the last few years. So there is, I think, a sort of movement towards social consciousness within the profession. And at the same time, we've seen you know, heads of many large architectural institutions becoming head by women. So we had Amal Andros at Columbia, Monica Ponce de Leon at Princeton, and Deborah Burke at Yale. And it's really, I think, highlighting a new phase in architecture.
Yeah, I was just last week in Chicago for the architecture biennial, and just one of the articles that came back was really talking about how this biennial is not about the architecture, it's more about people who are engaging in design in different ways. The article also had an amusing quote that architecture seems to have a lot of daddy issues. Also, last weekend, I was at Harvard Design School for the first ever Black in Design conference, and it was absolutely incredible. The day started with a yoga session where everyone got up out of their seats, because this whole idea, like, it's not just the brain, there's the body. We actually have a body, everyone? This is amazing, right? So it's really about upending what a conference looks like. There were no yawns in the room. You know, everyone was really engaged. And the keynote speaker at the end was Phil Freelon, who collaborated with David Adjaye on the Museum of African American History that's filling in that little but very significant hole in the National Mall with the new museum opening. This is really tied in. African American Student Union at GSD created this conference in collaboration with the Harvard Design School and alumni and a lot of people helping. But I really thought what for me was really significant was that this was, again, it's not a racial issue, it's not a gender issue, although it's important to look at those underrepresented groups, and that's what they were doing. But I thought it was really beautiful that this is dedicated to the pursuit of just and equitable spaces across all scales, okay? And we hope that this conference will serve to ingrain a compassion for human beings into the ethos of design more broadly, as well to serve as a call to action that the GSD instill within each and every person who passes through its doors the responsibility to build just and equitable spaces at every scale. So it's an incredible moment. And I think it will be repeated yearly.
And just to kind of close it in and go back to this idea of recording, I want to read a quote by Beatrice Colomina, where she writes that correcting the record is not just a question of adding a few names or even 1,000 to the history of architecture. It's not just a matter of human justice or historical accuracy, but a way to more fully understand architecture and the complex ways it is produced.